The first thing that we want to talk about today is Maxwell's equations. There are four Maxwell's equations. I'm going to show them to you in point form. That means that they are correct at a specific point in space. Here's the first one, that the divergence of the electric flux density is equal to the volume charge. What that means is that I have a volume charge density, let's think of an individual charge, and it creates an individual flux line. If I had a charge per meter cubed, I would end up with so many electric flux lines. That's what this first Maxwell's equation means. The second Maxwell equation is that the curl of the electric field is equal to the time derivative of the magnetic field. This is the Faraday's law equation, and this is saying that a time-varying magnetic field produces an electric field. The third Maxwell's equation says that the divergence of the magnetic field or magnetic flux density is equal to zero. If you compare these two Maxwell's equations, you can see that this is like saying that the magnetic field charge is equal to zero. That's not really charge density, but the magnetic field charges are equal to zero. The fourth Maxwell's equation is that the curl of the magnetic field is equal to the conduction current density, given in amps per meter cubed, plus the amps per meter squared, excuse me, plus the time derivative of the electric flux density is equal to the magnetic field. Here you can see that a time-varying electric field produces a magnetic field. Now, if we assumed that all of these fields, E or H, are a function of e to the j omega t, that these are sinusoidal fields with a specific frequency omega, then we can see that the time derivative of e to the j omega t is j omega, e to the j omega t. So any place that we see a time derivative, we simply substitute j omega. For instance, in here, if we want to convert this to phasor form, we've got this minus sign here, then there's this time derivative, which becomes j omega, and then it's b. Down here, here's our time derivative, so this becomes jc, and then this plus j omega, replacing the derivative, d. There are a few other substitutions that I'd like to make in here. The first one is that D is equal to epsilon E and B is equal to mu H. So right here we can put mu H, and right here we can put epsilon, which is epsilon naught times epsilon R times the electric field. The other replacement we'd like to make is for conduction current density, and that is that this is conductivity times the electric field. Now we have our four Maxwell's equations, 1, 2, 3, 4. We have them in the time domain on the left, and we have them in the phase or frequency domain on the right. There's one other piece that we'd like to pull in here, and let's take a look right here at this part of Maxwell's equations. This is sigma times the electric field plus j omega epsilon naught times epsilon r, all of these times the electric field. This right here is often written as j omega times the complex epsilon. Complex epsilon, epsilon c, is, or sometimes written as epsilon star in some textbooks, is epsilon naught times epsilon r minus j sigma over omega, where omega, of course, is 2 pi times the frequency in hertz. This is also written as something called epsilon prime. You can see that right here, this part is epsilon prime, minus j epsilon double prime. So this is epsilon double prime. So these are the four Maxwell's equations, and they're very important to us, and they're what help us figure out how waves propagate. If we had a charge-free region, that's also a very important approximation. So if we have a charge and current-free region, that means there's no charge and there's no current in this region, then rho v goes to zero, and the conduction current goes to zero. So in that case, we have that the divergence of the electric flux density is equal to zero. Of course, the divergence of the magnetic flux density is equal to zero. The curl, or the cross product of the electric field, is still minus dB by dt. And we also have del cross H is equal to time derivative of the electric flux density. Now, these two equations are normally not very interesting for us to solve. They're interesting equations, but they're not used in our solutions. These two equations right here are what we're going to use in the solution of all of our waves. Because the magnetic field generates the electric field, and because the electric field generates the magnetic field, these two equations kind of go in a circle. You can see how it's going from B to E and from E back to B. That means that these two are coupled first order differential equations. They are differential in both space. This is related to spatial d by dx, d by dy, d by dz, and there's also a time domain derivative. So we have coupled first order differential equations. It means that we have to solve both of these equations simultaneously at the same time in order to get the correct solution.